I'm doing is documenting and updating this Visio. And I'm taking the scope down for the lab because we cannot put that much stuff on the lab. So in here, I believe that HQ is using 16 addresses, if I recall correctly. They are using 16s, okay. So I'm gonna use 17s for our inner routing protocol. So let's start off with this 172.17.0.1/30. Bam. So actually, I probably should start from the left, shouldn't I? Just for posterity's sake. Alright. So if we have four VDOMs, I think that that 60E or 60F could probably hold four VDOMs. I believe is the next one. Or is it 8? There we go. Alright. So this is saved. So this is what we're going to build. And I also updated your physical links because you had this as red and you had all this down here as red. So these are physical. This entire thing here is virtual. So if we take this and 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 this, oops, and don't deselect it by accident. Actually, let's get these two. And let's insert a container to visualize. Go Visio, it's your birthday. There we go. All right. So this is a 60F firewall. And the rest of this is gonna be stuff that is virtualized inside of it. Makes sense? All right. So this is what I'm gonna build, and I'm just gonna ignore that the 16s exist here because it already exists. Now I did delete like the LDAP servers, and I deleted a whole bunch of other stuff. So because it's a 60F, you have to manually enable VDOMs with the CLI. I believe it's M for multi VDOM mode, multi-factor authentication. Nope, that was right. It is set VDOM mode, I believe multi. Yeah, multi. Bam. Yes, and it is going to log you out. Connection lost. So now, should have multi VDOM. And you have an admin on this, right? Okay. So we have multi VDOM mode. So we have root in here. So I'm going to build it off of this diagram. Let's go ahead and put this over here. And we'll go to global system VDOM. And then we are going to create a new one, and we're going to create a bunch of NAT-based ones. So we're just going to call this infrastructure. Oh, at most 11 characters. Okay. There we go. Maybe I should come up with a better name for that. We'll just call it hosts. How about that? Bam. Hosts. People. Servers. DMZ. And honestly, I probably should go back in here. We should probably really consider putting central NAT on these new VDOMs because it just makes life so much easier. Oh, all right, so root, operation mode. All right, so that one's changed. Let's put these in a central NAT. Do you understand what central source NAT is? So, you know how you're allowed to NAT on a policy level in the firewall? So you can go into the firewall policy and NAT per policy. So this takes that functionality and it centralizes it into a single console. So when you go in here, instead of having it as a policy option, you have it as its own like table option. Doo-doo-doo, close the dashboard. Central source NAT. And it's basically just taking the same functionality and moving it. So like you could say anybody coming from this network to anywhere is gonna NAT to this IP address. Phones are going to NAT to this IP address, et cetera, et cetera. You can also do it by protocol, too. So it just makes it easier to manage when you get a firewall that's large and has a lot of stuff in it. It makes it easier to manage it through a central table. And then because you have source NAT, you then have destination NAT, right? So you can create a destination NAT, which is a VIP. And do the same stuff. All right. So we've got four VDOMs. And do you need to take a screenshot of this picture? Actually, let's put some details in here. All right, so let's do VLAN 20. VLAN 21, VLAN 23. So make the third octet matches VLAN number. All right, so take a picture of that. What I want you to do is to program the server and DMZ VDOMs with a base configuration that allows traffic to flow through. Got that? Kevin? Oh, you're good. All right, so transparent. So I gotta go into the VDOM, don't I? Config VDOM. Well, I'm gonna go global context still. Config VDOM edit. Pretty sure it's system settings. There we go. Operation mode. Oh yeah, I gotta set a management IP, don't I? So it, in a normal, if you were to set a normal transparent VLAN or VDOM or firewall, let's say firewall. If you were to set a normal transparent firewall, it would require a management IP. So even though this is a VDOM and we're accessing it through another firewall's management interface, we still need to do that. So incomplete command. Oh yeah, I gotta do subnet too. Bam. All right. So now it has some IP address that you manage it on that isn't gonna route anywhere, so it doesn't really matter. And let me pull this up over here. So on a network level, I believe we're doing NPU0. Okay, so NPU0 is going to be the top. And NPU1 is going to be the bottom for the transparent VLAN and VDOM. Alright, so we are going to assign this one to the transparent VDOM. So build your Emacs on NPU0 VLink 0. So let's do root. Actually, let's change all of it to CentralNet because I don't think I have root on CentralNet yet. Nope. All right. So now root is on CentralNet. And to start off with, until we get to the BGP portion, I'm going to put static routes up here on root to just kick these /16s where they need to go. Oh, I forgot I gotta create VDOM links too. That's what I need to do first. So in order to make VDOM links, you have to be at a global network interface level. So I wonder how many. Yep, too many characters. Alright, so we'll just stick with the first initial. Root to host, virtual link 0 and 1. Root to people, virtual link 0 and 1. Servers, virtual link, and I believe that we have a default route out to the internet. Yep, we have a default route out to the internet. Actually, let's go back into root first. So the default route out to the internet, and then we are going to do 172.20.0.0/16. And that is going to go to hosts. And that is going to be 172.17.0.1. Wait, no, dot 2. Going to go to 172.17.0.5. And that is going to be R to people. Is it supposed to be 6? Yep, I always get those mixed up. We'll go in the opposite direction. There we go. /16. Alright, so now we got routes from root to all of the VDOMs. Let's start here. We need to get a static route from the VDOM out to the root firewall. So for this one, it's going to be 172.17.0.1. And for this one, it is going to be 172.17.0.5. Alright, so now all the VDOMs have routes out. So on the root firewall, I'm going to create a bridge policy that lets all these VDOMs get out to the internet. And we should be able to verify this by pinging from the firewalls downstream. Let's just do it below that. So we're going to let everything get to the WAN. Still throws me off that they changed SD-WAN like that. Alright, so I do want to net this traffic, and I do want to log this traffic. Alright, so we should be able to come from here. And we can ping Google. We have success. All right. So what do you do on your VDOM? Which one are you starting on? Which one of the firewalls are you working on right now? This lab. All right, so let's start on the host. We need to create. Oh yeah, you only got one screen. All right. No worries. So this is the host firewall, right? So we need a network for the switch, and we need a network for the hypervisor for management, right? And those are going to go on the host, right? I named it infrastructure to start off with, but that's too big of a name for VDOM, so. So the management IP of both of these is going to be on the host. So what's my next step? I want to create these three VLANs on this VDOM. What do I do next? What VDOM people? Yeah. Yep, people's built. Yeah, you weren't just watching me do all that? Yeah, I just verified that by pinging Google from a VDOM in the middle. Yeah, what do I need to do to build out the VLAN inside of the VDOM? So how do I do that? Yeah, that's what the EMAC VLAN does. So an EMAC VLAN, which I don't know how much you've been able to read on these yet. Fair enough. So an EMAC VLAN is an enhanced MAC VLAN. So basically, you can give it an IP address. You know how the gateway of the VLAN has a MAC address, right? So like whatever the gateway is, the .1 or whatever, it has a MAC address that says it's the .1. So an enhanced MAC VLAN allows you to do that many, many, many times and to give each member of that VLAN a unique MAC address. So that way you can route traffic to it individually. So that is the magic that makes this particular concept possible. And you create it just like you do a normal VLAN, except you're gonna make it an EMAC VLAN. You can't change the name. So naming structure is important. So let me move this over to the other screen. So we'll call this EMAC 200-1. Because you can have 254 of these. VLAN 200 gateway. And I'm going to tie this to NPU link 0, VLink 0. And I have no idea why VRF is on. But we're going to stick with a one routing table, so we don't have to worry about that. So VLAN 200, and this is going to go into the host virtual domain. And that is going to be 172.20.200.1/24. And we're going to let it be pinged. So we're going to repeat that process for each VLAN on each, right? So I don't know that we necessarily need all of these. We can have one VLAN there and one VLAN on each of these as far as proof of concept goes. So build out VLAN 190 on the people VDOM using an EMAC VLAN. And I will build out VLAN 210 on the server VDOM. Oops, I gotta go to global. You have to be in global context to do this and assign the VDOM, by the way. So EMAC 1, 2, 10. And this is going to go into the servers. So once we get BGP up, we'll add more VLANs and we can illustrate how the routing tables update dynamically. But for now, one VLAN on each VDOM will get us our proof of concept. And let me know when you're done. How you doing over there? Yeah, the alias isn't hard to change. The name is the real thing to change. But that's not the right number. Yes. 190. All right. Yep. I made it to Legend League. So now I need to. Now I need to fail so that I can get out of Legend League. So I hope that they kick me out tomorrow. Alright, what's next? Can you explain that a little bit more clearly? So that is correct. What interface type are you going to create for that one? Uh-huh. And what interface is that VLAN going to get bound to? Exactly. All right. And how are you going to differentiate that from the EMAC VLAN interfaces you created? So I told you they need to have unique names for the interface, right? So, if it's a VLAN 190 on the NPU side, what is the physical port VLAN going to be? So you got an interface, here, and you got an interface here, but then you also have an interface here, right? So if I go into, we'll just stay global with the interface. All right, so this one is going to be VLAN 200. How do you want to differentiate the virtual from the physical? With a V and a P? Okay, so this is going to be a VLAN on NPU VLink 1 with VLAN tag 200, and it is going to belong to the transparent VDOM. And then we're going to do the same thing. So this one is going to be VLAN 200-physical. And, oh, you know what? Bummer. Okay, I gotta do that first, don't I? So, I need to actually give it a physical interface to that VDOM. So I'm gonna use 5. And then we're gonna plug port 5 up into that Arista above it to get the VLAN traffic across. Alright, so now port 5 is isolated. I'm going to remove it from root and give it to the transparent VDOM. So now when I go to create a VLAN, I should be able to put it on internal 5 with 200 and give that to the transparent VDOM. Alright, so now VLAN 200 has a path all the way from the physical switch up through the bridge over VLAN, across EMAC, and up to the host VDOM. And then from the host VDOM, it will route out using its default gateway to get to the root VDOM. Right? So what's the next step? Uh-huh. Go for it. You got this, Skippy. Yeah, so when you do, when you look at the interfaces at the global level, you can move them in between VDOMs. So if you actually go to the VDOM, if you go to transparent, because you're in the transparent context of that VDOM, you're only going to be able to create interfaces on this VDOM. Right? But you see, so you can do that. But for the other ones where we're kind of bridging the virtual link across VDOMs, it's easier just to do it at the global level. So we'll take this, and so I need you to trunk VLAN 200, 210, or let's do 190, 200, 210, 220. Let's say to port. I want to say probably 12 is empty. Let's trunk that to port 12 on the switch. So we'll put this over here for the switch. And then... hello. So then we'll do port 13 goes to the hypervisor. Do you know how to re-IP the hypervisor? You know how to log into the hypervisor? So how do you change the IP on something? There you go. What are you going to set it to? We'll give it 172.20. What was it, 200? 200.2. Well, it needs to be redone because it's on the old lab configuration, right? 200. We'll give the switch 2 and we'll give the hypervisor 3. So on your VLAN, the VLAN 200 give it an IP address on that VLAN, and that way we can remote into this firewall and manage that switch remotely. On the switch, yeah. Set an IP interface that matches this. And I'll send you a copy of this before we get done tonight. Alrighty. How you coming along over there? Well, I'm gonna put myself on mute and go get these kiddos ready for bed, so I'll be right back.
fridge.
Me too. All right, how you doing over there, Kevo? Oh, you're not going to do it remotely? You need to do that when you're at the office tomorrow? So, the... Well, the tunnel's down, and when you change the IP address, it's going to change its gateway, so like the switch needs to be configured first. Right. So this is a, that part is a tomorrow task. We can, once we have the physical switch and the physical hypervisor all in the same VLAN, then the next thing that we can do is we can build servers and have devices on each of those VLANs, and then we can show how that traffic is routing and verify that everything's working correctly and do a proof of concept with everything. So then we can go up here and have traffic from the people VDOM going to the host VDOM and the server VDOM, right? So we can just pretend and simulate user traffic in an enterprise. Rousey is pregnant. Extra. Yeah, it's a news headline I just read. So what is on internal two? Why is that? What interface did I build out the other one on? I'm looking at it. Look at my screen. So you gave it internal 3 and internal 2, it looks like. Or maybe internal 2 was there already. Why is it on internal 2? It needs to be on internal 5, because that's going to be the physical connection that goes to the switch. That's what I built the other VLAN on. Yeah, that's going to be the physical trunk that leaves the transparent firewall and goes to the switch. for two. Because you have a reference. Because you created an address object for it. So you need to go into your references, right? So like on your interface table, over here on the right side, you have references. You can't delete something that has references, but it's a link. So if you click it, it'll tell you where the reference is in the firewall. So there, this has an address object referencing this interface. So you have to delete the address object first. And then once there's, once you have zero references to it, you can delete the interface. And then I'm gonna go up to the global and take your interfaces away. Because this one only needs two interfaces. Yeah, you built a VLAN on interface 3 too, by the way. Woohoo. So we got the physical side and we've got the virtual side. All right. So the next thing that we need to do is to make some policies. So we've got traffic that can route. So we're just going to start off with some open policies so that we can verify routing and everything. See this little nifty? Look at this. Central NAT is enabled, so NAT settings for matching central NAT policies will be applied. It's gonna go sluggish because we have 6 VDOMs on a 60F firewall. Just for the record. That's a lot for one of those little dinky firewalls. Even though the 60Fs have the brand new chipset, that's still a fair load for one of these things. So you need a policy to get out from that interface, right? So all the traffic from the EMAC VLAN, which this needs to be by sequence. So all the traffic from VLAN 200 is going to be going out to the internet, right? And then you also want to clone the reverse so that we can verify routing. We're going to turn this one off because everything should just NAT to get up here. But to start off with, we're just going to leave open policies. And I want you to do that on the other three firewalls. People, servers, and DMZ. And I am going to create a bridge policy on the transparent firewall. Oh, you know what? I need to enable multiple interface policy. don't know that I should be configuring VPN on this.
Keeps taking the blanket away from me. The one I use overnight.
I'll be right back. How you doing over here? What's up? What do you mean? Send me a screenshot of what you're talking about. Well, show me how to do it. Go into a policy. And the transparent firewall? What's it? Oh, that's cool. I can see it. So what's wrong with all? It does have the interfaces that you selected. The all is the address objects, not the interfaces. Alright, so if you go to the transparent firewall, you see how I created bridge policies for these? Do you? So create one for 220. Alright, so what are next steps? The switch and the hypervisor, yes. So from here, you're going to go down on port 5. All right. It's called internal 5 on the firewall. So port 5 is going to go down to port 12 here. And then these VLANs need to be tagged on it. And if you need to write this down, write this down. This is a list. Then you need to assign a layer 3 interface to VLAN 200 on the switch and give it this IP address. And then you need to trunk port 13 to have all these VLANs. And then you need to physically probably get a mouse and keyboard, if I had to guess, and plug into this hypervisor. You know where the password to the hypervisor is? Okay. So you have your own login for it? Okay. So log into that, change the IP address to this one, and then you should be able to ping the .1. That will let you know that you're making it across this path here. And if not, we can troubleshoot why you're not. Internal 5 physically connected to port 12 on the switch. Port 12 trunked with these VLANs. Port 13 trunked with these VLANs. Layer 3 interface on the switch so that we can manage it. Layer 3 interface on the switch so that we can manage it with this IP address. For what? Say that again? Oh, not for the hypervisor. Are you looking at my screen? And I just sent you that document in the chat. Now I want you to write out all of these tasks in order in the chat. You can just copy paste whatever you just took notes on. All right. Alright, so you're missing one. You don't need to assign VLAN 200 to interface 5 because that is already assigned with this right here. So this is a VLAN that rides interface 5, see? So it's already tagged on interface 5, and this policy will let that traffic get out. So you need to put those VLANs on port 12 and port 13 of the Arista switch. And port, yeah. That's all she wrote. So through after we get that done, we should be able to validate layer 3 connectivity from the firewall to the hypervisor. So we should be able to configure and get access to it through the VPN. And then we can build servers on it, and we can put one of them on each of those VDOMs, and then we can simulate traffic, one routing up to and through the firewall and back down as designed. And then two, we'll be able to simulate BGP traffic because we're gonna create new VLANs. And then they should automatically get updated in the route table. Does all that make sense? All right. Well, that's all I have for tonight. We got a lot of stuff done. Well, let's work out the kinks in the lab first. Well, that's good. I'm glad to hear that. All right. Well, I'm going to jump off here and get this video processing and uploading so then I can share it to you guys tomorrow morning. Sound good? You're welcome, man. Have a good night.